I would, and I would say that, you know, if one looks closely at the scourge marks, you'll see that many of them, if not the majority, broke the skin, tore the flesh. There are blood stains on many of the scourge marks. So, you know, when people tell me, oh, well, this is just a fake, and you know, the forensic experts who've studied the shroud have looked at that piece of cloth as if it were a crime scene. And when a forensic, when three, no less than three forensic experts who've really delved into this have come back and said, look, this is absolutely anatomically correct. The blood stains are correct. Everything is correct. I just can't buy into the forger thing. And those scourge marks are a part of that evidence.
Well, it's other, you know, I also read at length about the wounds in the wrists, and they're not in the palms of the hand.
Correct.
It's very important to note these are in the wrist because the palms would not support an adult man crucified. The palms would rip through the fingers. And various photographs, I think, show in tremendous detail the not only the wrist wounds, but the way the blood flowed on the arms when the arms were crucified. And I read at length about this in the Shroud Codex because I think it's one of the more horrifying details. I mean, the record of how the man in the shroud was crucified tells you a lot about how the Romans really brutalized Jesus Christ. And it's the story of a political crucifixion. I mean, the Romans crucified thousands of people. Some they just tied to the cross
right. And
let stay there for hours. But when you examine Barry's photographs, it just makes it snap alive for you. It's a whole other dimension.
Well, one of the other things that's important about those bloodstains at the wrist, the Romans did these crucifixions so often that they were expert at it. They didn't need to try and figure out where do we drive the nails. They knew exactly where to drive.
They knew what to do and
they
how
knew
long
exactly.
It would take a body to die, right?
Exactly. So when I look at the bloodstains on the shroud and you look at any depiction of the crucifixion of Jesus other than modern ones that are actually based on the shroud, but any going back through history, always the nails in the palms of the hands. Well, you know, the arms are pretty strong, and when somebody's torturing you that way, you could tear your hand loose, whether the body weight or not would tear through it. You could actually pull it loose if you were nailed in the palm, right between the phalanges there. By nailing it in that kind of fleshy part near the wrist, but the fleshy part of your palm close to the wrist, and at a slight angle, you're going to see an exit wound, which is what we see, by the way, on the shroud. You're going to see an exit wound at the wrist. So why would an artist, a forger, a hoaxer in medieval times go against everything he'd ever seen and put them in the forensically correct place instead of where every artist would have has depicted these nails? So that's another important piece of the evidence puzzle.
It also impressed me, various photographs of the feet, because the feet, one foot was crossed over at the other. And so the feet, especially in the dorsal view, I believe it's what the right foot that was against the crossbar. Is that correct?
That's what's believed. What we see on the shroud, it's very interesting. We see a blood mark from a heel. That leg was stretched out completely. Then we see a complete footprint of blood and stains on the shroud. And the only way that a human being can lay his foot flat is to bend his knee. Well, one knee was bent. The body was in rigor mortis. Perhaps from after being taken off the cross, and his body was already in rigor. And so again, we have another important piece of evidence here that what's depicted there is not typical of any kind of artworks of any kind of Christian art of Jesus. It's just not at all what we see on the shroud.
Well, and even how a modern artist could have gotten this anatomical detail so precise. I mean, when you look at Barry's photographs, it's not just that you see the full foot on one of the feet that was pressed against the cross and the blood mark,
mm-hmm. But
the other foot, you just see a slight imprint of the blood, which clearly means the foot was pressed on top of the other, and the bent knees in the photographs are a clear indication of how the body was placed on the cross. So the photographs, I think, do two things. One, they document anatomically correct images that would have been almost impossible for any artist, even today, to duplicate in the detail you see in Barry's photographs. But secondly, they document a story of the brutality with which this man was crucified, which identically corresponds to the story that's in the Gospels. I mean, crucifixion of Jesus Christ was a political crucifixion. I think that's an important point to remember.
You know, and we talked earlier, Jerry, that if this is real, if they ever find Noah's Ark, and, you know, that ends up being real, then it's got to tell you that the rest of the stories in the Bible are real, and that would include Genesis, and that's a remarkable story. And well, then Revelation, you have to think about that, don't you?
Well, I agree. And, you know, George, World Net Daily, we've documented so much. It's one of the themes of World Net Daily, that the Bible is documentable. And the evidence, even if you look at the evidence of the Second Temple, I mean, recently there's been some coins found in Jerusalem with the burn marks. I've been in Jerusalem many times. I've gone through the various sites, including the archaeological sites, where you can see the burn marks from the Romans in 70 AD, I believe it was, destroying the Second Temple. The Bible is historically documentable. And that's what's so incredible about the various photographs in the Shroud. It's like looking into the Bible in real time. It's like it's actually right there in front of you.
Well, you know, not being a New Testament guy, I had a lot of learning and catching up to do, and once I really got involved with the Shroud, one of the things I noticed about the gospel accounts of what happened to Jesus, I believe there's four different accounts, and they're not exactly the same. And that, to me, indicates truth, because humans don't ever do anything exactly the same way each time. And if each of those stories had been exactly the same, I would have probably been less likely to accept them. There is enough variation within the story for me to accept that that was a reasonably good document of what was done to Jesus. And when you compare that to the Shroud, it's so identical. I once had a skeptic say to me, oh, well, the Shroud can't be real. It's too perfect. And I said to him, so if it were less perfect, then you'd accept it as authentic? He said, of course not. So those of us who've studied the Shroud from a scientific point of view have sort of got to face that reality all the time, that we're always going to be challenged, we're always going to be criticized, and no matter where the evidence lies, no matter where it's published, there's going to be skeptics. It's just one of the things that we have to contend with when you're dealing with something at this level of controversy.
Well, if, for some reason, it was created, when might that have been done? If let's take the posture for a moment, it's some rendition of an artwork. You don't believe it. I don't believe it. Jerry doesn't believe it. But when do you think it was done? When do you think they had that capability?
Oh, 50 years from now, perhaps.
From now, right?
From now. Because, look, every effort, including the recent Garlicelli effort, which was a pretty good effort, I have to admit, still didn't pass any of the tests. So, you know, and they have my photographs of the Shroud to work from, and the other more recent photos even. So, you know, if we can't duplicate it after we've characterized the chemistry and physics of it, if we can't duplicate it when we have great photographs of it available for anybody practically, you know, to me, you know, the irony of this is, just knowing about the bloodstains being on the cloth first, an artist would have first had to forensically accurately put bloodstains onto a blank sheet of cloth and then somehow create an image around those bloodstains that's forensically accurate. Well, that's ludicrous. Nobody can do that.
I spent a lot of time writing about this when I wrote the novel. And the issues, you know, when you take a look at Barry's photograph, just a little detail that hit me almost immediately was when you look at the shoulders and the dorsal view, there's a sloping to the shoulders, which is a natural characteristic of someone looking at them from the back, which, you know, an artist to do that, to capture those kind of details and the blood flows on the back from scourge wounds, would have had to have almost had a crucified body from which they were painting.
There are abrasions.
Incredible.
On the shoulders, Jerry, there are some abrasions there.
Correct.
That people have characterized as there's blood stains there as well that indicate that this man may have carried something across his shoulders that actually rubbed his skin raw there.